Let's talk about IUPAC nomenclature of alkenes. So this video specifically addresses an introduction to IUPAC nomenclature, considering alkanes, but predating IUPAC nomenclature involving priority groups and stereochemistry. So we're not quite there yet involving this video, and more videos will follow that add priority groups and stereochemistry to the equation. So let's look at our nomenclature roadmap. These are the four general steps that we have to do to give ourselves the most likelihood of getting the correct answer and getting to that IUPAC name. So the first three steps are like diagramming sentences. We're gonna circle the parent chain. We're gonna label the names of groups intersecting this circle, and then we're gonna number the chain physically on the page so that we have all the tools we need to put the name together using the proper formatting at the end. So the first three don't actually get us the name on paper, but they get us ready to assemble that name properly using all of the steps and tiebreakers involved. And so the details and the tiebreakers must be followed in order. So there is a rhythm to this, there is a method to it, and if we go in order, we will get to the right answer. If we go out of order, we're going to run into trouble. So number one, we have to identify this parent chain and the longest carbon-to-carbon chain. And if we have a carbon-to-carbon chain that's tied, multiple chains, then the most branched is going to win. Okay, so we've got to do enough practice to see that, and we'll look at a few examples at the end, getting the rules out here. There are more tiebreakers than this. My course will not look at examples with more tiebreakers than this, but you can find the additional tiebreakers in the IUPAC Blue Book, and currently it's available in an online HTML version, although that is not guaranteed to last forever, but currently it is there. So the next thing we've got to do is name the groups, and so we have our simple prefixes based on number of carbons, to which we add the suffix YL to, so methyl, ethyl, propyl, depending on how many group carbons there are. And then we have branched groups that have common names. Okay, so we're going to look at these first here. If we consider an infinitely long parent chain here that we have circled, intersecting this parent chain, we have an isopropyl group here. Okay, so the branching, this iso functionality here is what designates an iso group. And so I've included an isobutyl to kind of designate that. So four carbons, isobutyl, one, two, three, and four carbons. And then isopentyl, we would have five carbons involved. Again, that branching at the end is what gives it the iso. And iso is always acceptable. It's not ambiguous at all. However, there are only limited other prefixes that we can use and other designations. Secbutyl, for example, looks like this. And there is no other sec that we can use without being ambiguous. So secbutyl or S-butyl. And the butyl is alphabetized, but not the S. Iso does get alphabetized with the name. Okay, so we alphabetize by iso, but not by sec and not by tert. So butyl here and pentyl would be alphabetized. So we've got sec butyl, we have tert pentyl, or tert butyl, excuse me, and then tert pentyl as unambiguous groups. And then I've compared the iso group for isobutyl to sec butyl, again, considering this infinitely long parent chain. That's how they would look after you circle the chain. That's how they would look. Okay, so you're getting plenty of rules here, and examples teach this better, but we've got to get them down. So just copy these down or pause or whatever you have to do to get them down, because we're going to read through these a little bit fast and then practice as we go. So branch groups, groups of groups. We can name the ones that have common names as they are, or we could name those as branch groups or complex groups. And the way we do that is wherever we're attached to the parent chain, so here I'm going to circle the parent chain, wherever we're attached to the parent chain, we have to assign the number one to that position. Then we find the longest chain either way using the parent chain rules for that group, and we circle that. And then anything that's a group of a group, we give a name to, methyl, there's methyl again, and then we number that chain, 1, 2, 3, just like we did. So the one position's already there, but 1, 2, 3 on the group as well. And for this particular example, we write the name of the group, we place it in parentheses. It would be a 1,2-dimethyl, three carbons is a propyl, and it goes in parentheses in the final name. Okay, and so we'll practice putting those into a name momentarily. Okay, so number three in the roadmap, we've circled the parent chain, we've named our groups. Number three, we number the parent chain, we put the lowest number on the first group. So it doesn't matter how long the parent chain is, it's better to put a single one on a bromine on this side of the chain and put 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, two 11s here in the name than it is to put two twos and then 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11 on bromine. Okay, so it's much better to name it with a lower number initially than the average number. So the lowest number on the first group possible, and then if we have a tie, we move on to the next. And if there's an absolute tie, it depends on the alphabetical order of the group names, and we'll see that. Okay, for example, if we're numbering this chain, bromine wins. It gets the 2 instead of fluorine because it comes before fluorine in the alphabet. And the last thing we have to do is assemble the name. Okay, and every group that is named that intersects that circle has to get a number. If we have multiple of the same groups, we use this set of prefixes: di, tri, tetra, penta, hexa, hepta, octa, nona, and deca. Hopefully we won't have more than that. If we do, there are prefixes for it. We'll have to look those up. Separate numbers from numbers with commas. So if we have a 1,2-dimethyl, and separate letters from numbers with dashes. Okay, so we've got a dash here, and we've got a comma here. And then we order the groups in alphabetical order in the name, not based on the number, based on the alphabetical order. And we don't number based on alphabetical order unless we reach that tiebreaker. So we have to go in order to get the correct name. Parent name goes at the end with no spaces. Okay, so let's do a couple of examples where we put all the rules together. Rule number one, circle the parent chain. So we've got to have the most branches. We've got a couple options here. Okay, so we've got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Then 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Okay, and then if we go 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, we have a 7-membered parent chain. So most branches. So we circle this parent chain because we end up with three branches instead of two. Either of the other two would have only given us two branches, and the rule says we have to maximize the number of branches if there's a tie. So we have methyl, we have methyl, and we have 1, 2, 3 carbons is propyl. So there's number two. We write the names of the groups. Then three, we number the chain, putting the lowest number on any group. So we can put a 2 here or a 2 here, numbering from either side. 3, 4, 3, 4, so there's a tie. Looks like this is a symmetrical chain, so why not just pick one and go 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and 7. Okay, we can number the other way and get the same name because of symmetry there. And then finally, we put the name together following our rules. So we have in alphabetical order, a 2,6-dimethyl, 4-propyl, heptane. Okay, no spaces. For the second example, we have a 5-membered ring and a 1, 2, 3, 4, 5-membered chain. So the rule is, if we have a ring versus a chain, the ring, if it's tied in carbons, wins. If the chain's longer, the chain wins. If the ring is larger in number of carbons, then that wins. The one thing we cannot do is go through a ring and into a chain. So this is illegal. We cannot go past this point and take a ring into a chain. We have to separate the ring from the chain and pick one or the other. In this case, the tiebreaker, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 in a row versus a 5-membered ring, the ring wins. Write the name of the group. So we have a bromo. So alkyl halides end in O, bromo, chloro, fluoro, iodo, and then methyl again. And then finally, we have a 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 membered iso type group. So this is an isohexyl. We could also name it as a complex group and say, or either one, we could say, or carbon that attaches is carbon one, circle, methyl, and then 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, we have a 4-methyl-pentyl group. Okay, either or, isohexyl or 4-methyl-pentyl works. Let's name it two ways, okay? So if we name it as an isohexyl, the I gets alphabetized. If we name it as a 4-methyl-pentyl, we always take the first letter unless we have a 3-methyl-pentyl, then we would have to use the 3 instead of the 4. Okay, but since it's just letters at work here, unless everything's identical, the number drops out and we use the letter. So we're alphabetizing here. Okay, so let's do isohexyl first. Two different names based on how you decided to name those groups. So let's actually number the chain first. We forgot number 3. And so we've got to put the lowest number on any group. And so the lowest number could be a 1, 2, 3, 4. So a 1, 2, 3, 4. If we start with the methyl, 1, 2, 3, 4. So that's tied. And we can get a 1, 3. So the isohexyl's out because we can, the best we can do is 1, 3 there. So we end up putting a 1 on the bromo because it's alphabetically before methyl. We can do a 1, 2, 4 with both bromo and methyl, so we take the bromo since it's alphabetically first. We can lower the number that way. So back to putting the name together, we have a 1-bromo. Iso comes next, 4-isohexyl. 4-isohexyl, 1-bromo, 4-isohexyl, 2-methyl. Cyclo for the ring, parent chain is a cyclopentane. So 1-bromo, 4-isohexyl, 2-methyl, cyclopentane is put together. Now if we named it as a 4-methyl-pentyl, now 1-bromo still comes first, but then methyl versus methyl-pentyl, methyl ends, and methyl-pentyl still going, so the methyl is going to come first alphabetically. And then finally, making sure we put this in parentheses, we have a 4-methyl-pentyl cyclopentane. All one word, okay? So we've make sure we get that all in one word if we can. There we go. Okay, so 4, and then again, when we write this up here, we should put parentheses here. All right, 4-methyl-pentyl cyclopentane as we diagram this out. Last example. Okay, we've got quite a chain here, and so we want to pick the longest carbon chain with the most branches. So we've got a 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, a 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Okay, so that is 6 as well. That's 1, 2, 3, 4 branches. I think we've got one. 1, 2, 3, 4 branches looks right to me here as we went through those. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Okay, so 4 branches wins. The others seem to have only 3 branches each. And so then, as we write the names of the groups, fluoro, chloro, ethyl, and ethyl, okay? And looking through at numbering, number 3, we can number 2, 3, 4, 5, or a 2, 3, 4, 5, so we're tied as far as numbering goes. So we've got to resort to alphabet. So if we start with chloro versus fluoro, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6. So we lower the alphabetically first group in the name. So now that we've got it numbered, we can put this together. Chloro coming first. We have a 2-chloro. Ethyl comes next. 3, 4. Dimethyl. The di is not alphabetized. What you write up here is what gets alphabetized, not the prefixes. That's why we write those before we add the prefixes. So 3, 4 dimethyl, 5 fluorohexane.